So, good afternoon, everyone, and I'm very happy to be here for this edition of the Versus Virus Hackathon. My name is Manuela Cirilli. I work at CERN. I'm a particle physicist as background, and now I work on transferring technologies to medical applications. But today I'm not here with my, if you want, hat of medical applications expert. I'm here with my other hat of a communication expert. I have a background also in science communication and science journalism. And on the side, one thing that I've been doing for quite some time is to coach and teach people how to communicate, both in writing and in presentation style. So today, what I have for you is a presentation that was normally tailored to help you guys doing great presentations in a normal setting, what we were used to until before the COVID emergency started. So we'll do some tweaks to what I've been teaching so far, and basically I've been thinking about this stuff a bit live from the experience that was gathered during the past couple of months of teleworking for all of us. So my talk is titled How to Make Great Presentations, and I'll ask our collaborators to switch to the next slide, and I'm sorry because this is going to be a bit of a hassle for you, but that's the best way to stream the slides seamlessly. So if you go to next slide, this shows you visually what's the aim. What I'm going to tell you now is to give you some tools to avoid the death by PowerPoint effect, or in any case, to have the audience knocked out by your presentation because you're not being interesting enough. And next slide, you see it's loosely structured, my presentation along the three main points that I want to touch. One is the content. So what is your presentation going to be about? Second is design. So this talk is conceived for slide decks, but a lot of what I'm going to tell you can be used and translated also to video communication, because visual communication is not only about slides. And the third part is about the delivery, how you're going to deliver your speech and how you're going to actually connect with your audience. The next slide, something that is always important to keep in mind is that content is king, is your message that is going to drive how you package it and how you're going to deliver it. And in particular, if you have a technical presentation to give and to make the other people understand the complexities what you've been on the work that you've been doing, how you structure your story is important, but what you want to say, it's up to you to decide. The next slide, my slides are mainly visual. They are meant to give you an idea of, you know, what I want to convey in this talk. What you need to think first is how you want to structure your presentation. And it might seem trivial because we are all used to starting, okay, I'm going to slide one, two, and then we go to the next ones. Start getting into the habit of, before attacking your slides or the preparation of your speech or your video, to think about how you want to tell your story. The next slide gives you, your story can be very linear, so it can start, from, giving the context, then you walk the people through the main part of your presentation, and then you get to the end. But also, you could go from the start and end point in very different ways. The next slide shows you pictorially, something that we're all used to see. It is a typical subway map. This is from the London Tube, because it's renowned to be one of the most complex systems around. You could still go from the start point to an end point in very different ways. And it is up to you to decide how you want to walk your listeners or your audience, in any case, from that point to the other. And this is what is called storytelling. That's the next slide. So storytelling, you might think that if you have to give a pitch of 3 minutes, there's no story to tell. And that's not true. And it's actually the way to build your message so that it reaches the audience and it talks to them and captures their attention. So how do you do it? The first ingredient that you have to know is what is your audience? The next slide. You have to know who you are going to talk about. Who are these people? Are they expert in the fields, or are you going to be the expert? It's very different, this situation. Are you going to be in front of people who are a mix? Very often that's what happens. And at the point, you need to decide based on the information that you have on the audience, how you're going to talk to them. A very typical trap in which we fall a lot is to use a lot of jargon. The next slide is a typical example is using acronyms. Acronyms in particular, no matter where you're coming from, whether it's the business world, whether it's the tech world, whether it's academia, we use them every day at work with our peers. They do not translate in the same way outside. There was a time when I was working on something that was called TOBs, and for everyone in my team, TOBs were tiny objects, while for my husband, who was a physicist, a TOB was the tracker outer barrel of the experiment that he was building. So, you know, as soon as you move to another audience, an acronym that you think has only one meaning can be completely different in another setting. Another thing to pay attention to is the next slide is the intro slide. And this can be either visually or conceptually. How many times did you see presentations starting with an index like this? I'm going to tell you, as if it was a book, I'm going to tell you what's the project about, what have I been doing, and walk you through all my research or everything I want to tell you until I reach the conclusions. This is useless to people. It's at best, you know, information that doesn't add anything to your message. And in most cases, it's already making people disconnect from what you're saying. What you really want to do, next slide, is to quickly tell them, who are you? What are you going to talk about? And if you can tell them why this is important to them, then you get them already in your pocket. And all of this, you have to do it in a very, very short time. Next slide. Time is of the essence. I'm saying a minute or two when you're talking about a 20, 25 minutes presentation. Of course, if you have a 3-minute speech, well, that becomes already part of your presentation. I'm going to cover this a bit later. How do you actually tune your content and your text according to the length of time that you have available. Next slide. You see, an important thing that might seem, let's say, repetitive, but is very, very useful is to not only state at the beginning what you want to talk about, but to go back to it at the end. The longer the talk, the more important this becomes, because you might take your listeners by the end and accompany them through a story that you made for them that is very interesting. It can be so interesting that they forget why they're listening to you and what you wanted them to do in first place. So at the end of your presentation, give them the takeaway message and going back to your initial topic, that's extremely important. Next slide. What you need to do at the beginning is really to give them the big picture. No matter how specific is what you're going to talk about, it can be you know, that you're coming up with a very, very specific solution to something that looks like you know, a secondary problem, or it can be a very specific research topic. This still fits a broader scope. In the hackathon, for example, the broader scope will be exactly to fight the virus and the pandemic in ways that might seem at times smaller than others, but they're all very relevant. Tell the audience why this is important and also how does it relate to you. Typical for example, challenge that I've been having over the years at CERN whenever I give talks to the general public is why should I care about particles that I cannot see and that I don't even know that they are around? So trying to find a hook for people to relate to the topic that you're going to talk about. The next slide, what is going to make you remembered by the audience and what is going to make an impression is if you can add something extra to your presentation. So not only stick to the technicalities and to the you know, the beauty of your solution or your research, but to make it personal. You know, tell about the hurdles that you had to face, tell them about something funny that happened in the lab or when you were doing it. Tell them why what you're doing is exciting, interesting, etc. Give them something to remember. If you have a good quote, if you have a powerful image, a visual image that they can keep in mind that relates to what they're telling, this is going to work typically very well. Remember one thing, and this is on the next slide, you're not obliged to tell jokes. I've heard many people attempting at doing jokes during talks. It rarely goes well unless you are a natural at this. You can still be funny and have people laughing without necessarily have to go overboard. And that's always important to keep. It's nice if the audience can laugh with you, but it's not a prerequisite. If you don't feel like doing it, don't. That's the golden rule to keep in mind when presenting. The next part of what I'm going to talk about is a bit about visual design. And as I said at the beginning, this is aimed at slides, but it's true for any type of visual communication. And you should already get a hint, I've gotten a hint of what I want to tell you by looking at my slides so far. You might have noticed, you see in the next slide, that I don't have that much text on my slides, typically because, and today we are in a very different setting, but still, if I'm talking and I'm saying exactly what is written in the slide and reading it, you are going to read the slides and not listen to me, or vice versa. And it's really because, the next slide, we are not wired to read and listen at the same time with the same degree of attention. You might be listening to a song while you're reading, but you're either paying attention to your reading or to the song. And if you want the people to focus on what you're saying, you have to use a visual communication for what it is. The next slide. Visual communication, it's a way of communicating. And it doesn't mean using words as in the audio communication, if you want, in the spoken language. It's a complement, in this case, to the communication. And there's all sorts of different types of visual communication that you can use as tools. A typical thing that we all use one moment or the other are slides. Because it's still the easiest means to build a visual communication for every non-expert in other tools, for example, like putting together a video, an animation, etc. A couple of things to remember. The next slide. Slides are not handouts, even though in some cases, especially for those of us who have to give lectures, or if you have to prepare a long presentation, it's just easier at times to put everything in your slide deck so that then it also remains a sort of documentation. Also, slides are not memory aids, as the next slide is. They should not be for you to remember what you want to say. And it's actually a very good exercise to have the slides up there just to remind you globally what you wanted to say on that particular topic, but not to be there to be read. And for me, it actually is something that actually started in a very See, well, maybe now it's funny way, but it was rather upsetting at the time. I have a visual impairment, and at some point I realized that I didn't manage to read my slides properly when I was in a presentation setting, because just I had to turn my head at a very awkward angle, for example, to look at the slides, and my vision was not very good. And so at some point the slides were useless to me. And this has actually been very useful because it pushed me to use the slides for what they should be, a support for what I want to say. You also have to remember in the next slides that a good design of slides, videos, any visual support is not just about making things pretty, it's also because they can help the audience understand what you want to say. And this is true also when your content is very scientific. You might think, you know, a plot is a plot, or a technical drawing is a technical drawing. But the next slide shows you how you can take this exact same plot and make it more readable for the audience, just because you are taking some care into making the axis readable, into making the picture big, not just copying the caption from your paper or adding a lot of text, etc. So this is also a very useful concept to keep in mind whenever you have to translate you know, technical content for a lay audience. What do they really have to grab from this plot? And it will oblige you to throw away from the slide anything that is absolutely not relevant. I spend a couple of words on the tools, because of course I'm talking about slide decks at the moment. And the question that I get always asked when I give this type of presentation is, well, should I use PowerPoint, or is PowerPoint a good tool? The next slide. Tools are neither good nor bad. They are either suited or not suited for what you want to do. I went all the way, you can see in the next slide, I come from this type of world. I'm pretty sure that, you know, probably 95% of you guys listening to me at the moment, I've never seen something like this. These were called transparencies in the scientific world. So it was a clear plastic piece of paper on which we were writing by hands our presentation, printing our plots, putting them on a projector and showing them to the public. Was this a good or a bad tool? It depends what you make out of it. I went all the way from you know, these things to the discovery of PowerPoints, animation, videos, etc. And nowadays, I mostly do a PDF file because it's the easiest way to get my slides to look the way I want them to look on any support with just a few great pictures. And I found out that this is what works best for me. So the tools that are out there are only as good as they serve the purpose that you want them to serve. Next slide, I want to go back again to the concept that visual communication can really help you to pass your message to the audience and to be effective. So what you see here is something that it can be useful for you afterwards, is some of the golden rules of what you should be avoiding when you're preparing a slide deck or a visual presentation. You should be avoiding to have too much text, too many fonts, etc. Now, what will you remember about these slides? Not so much. You'll have to go back to your notes or see it just to remember what's written in there. But if I show you the next slide, where I tell you that you should avoid too small text in a very, very visual manner, or the next slide that tells you to avoid too many fonts, this you will remember because it's very visual. You don't have to remember every single word that I tell you, but you will remember the concept. And this is what is really, really important to remember when you are preparing your visual presentation. In terms of fonts, the next slides, there are no golden rules, but in general, you should stick to two or three really nice fonts in your presentation. There are several resources that I'm giving you here for downloading very nice fonts to use. There are also some written or not non-written rules about which fonts to use in the next slide. And some of them are considered good, some are considered bad. And if you think, well, you know, in the end it's personal, yes and no. Fonts are also part of the visual communication. And the next slide will show you very visually how you can write the same text with two different fonts and get completely different message across. Also, fonts have, you know, a sort of a general acceptance in the world, and you might not be aware of how a certain community considers a certain font as being, for example, very unprofessional in some ways. There was a case, and this is a now by now old anecdote, but I still like to tell it because it's very it's funny and very telling at the same time. It was back in 2013, I think. You go to the next slide. Or maybe it was 2012, the first announcement of the discovery of the Higgs boson. So, of course, everybody was tuned to our to the CERN webcast to listen to our scientists presenting the results. So, of course, one of the tags that was the hashtags that was trending on Twitter at the time was Higgs. But if you look at the next slide, the other tag that was also trending was Comic Sans. Why? Because one of the presentations from our now director general was done using Comic Sans font. And honestly, I think at the time, the majority, if not all of the presentations of particle physicists were done using that font. Why? Because it was the default in PowerPoint when we started using it, because we considered it okay, funny, etc. And we didn't pay attention ever to how the external world was seeing this. And you wouldn't imagine what happened in the world. Also, we still refer to this period as the font gate. There were videos, there were articles on the newspapers, and there were anchor men and women talking about the fact that, you know, CERN used a funny font, a font that was for kids, and it was not serious enough to announce a major scientific discovery. It was considered inappropriate. And for us, it was funny at one end, but also totally surprising. Messages, you can still use these fonts. And actually, we kept using it. And our director general still happily keeps using the font, as became a trademark, if you want. But be aware of what you're walking into and what could be the consequences of it. Next slides. This is something that should be obvious, but it's not sometimes. Bad color choices can really affect the quality of your visual communication in every type of communication that you're doing. It can be exactly slides, videos, etc. So you normally should stick to a color scheme with a few colors. That's the next slide. And you choose it and you stick to it. If you see my slides, I've been using basically a white, black, and a turquoise, and then pictures on top of it. And speaking of pictures, the next slides, images can be very, very powerful and can tell indeed more than 1,000 words. It's also very long and extenuating process to find the right image on Google or on any other repository, and to always, and you will see it in my slides, I always attribute the images. It's something that you have to get in the habit of doing. So it's not straightforward, but it pays well, because once you found the perfect image, or sometimes I just went out with my camera and took the picture I wanted if I couldn't find it. And if it's something that, you know, a type of talk or presentation or concept that you use a lot, it's really worth the investment in time, because you will reuse it for a long, long time. Images can also help you to translate bullet points, for example, in a different way. In the next slide, this is typical outline of one of my technical talks, that is from particle physics tools to medical applications. A very usual way and typical way of doing it is to just give to my readers, you know, the breakdown that I'm going to talk them about accelerators, detectors, and computing and their applications in radiotherapy for cancer, medical imaging, and big data for health in general. I can also do the same thing visually, and you see it in the next slides. So I can see, I can show them actually accelerator, detectors, computing, and the next slide, the corresponding pictures for on the top radiotherapy and on the bottom medical imaging and data for health. It's a lot of work, but I keep using these slides year afterwards until I get tired of them and I'm ready for something new. I already told you on the next slide, but really, really pay attention to it, to always attribute your images. There are search engines which are specialized in finding images by the right of usage. And don't forget to also use a license for your visual creative work. Typically, Creative Commons on the next slide is a very, very good choice to protect your intellectual property, in the sense that it's not that you don't want other people to reuse it, but what you would like very often is just for other people to refer back to you and not to, for example, misuse some animation that you made or some graphics in a totally different context. Now, what I said is very nice, but it's not always applicable. You see it in the next slide. Very often you will have slides that or contents that is too complicated to just be resumed in a slide, or you just want to give some messages to the people and you will have no other way than just write it down. Still, you can get in the habit of cleaning up what you do. You see the next slide is exactly the same concept. I shortened a bit the text. I got rid of the bullet points. It seems silly, but even just getting rid of the bullet points does a lot for readability. If you can try to make each of your sentences no longer than a line, because every time that you have to scan back to the beginning, then it's always tiring and people are losing the concept. And identifying some keywords can also help your readers. It's also very important if you want to look professional and not look as if, you know, just put together the slides the night before, which of course is something that can happen in your daily life. But if you're giving an important talk, you might not want this to be the case, is to give your slides unity. That's in the next slide. This means to use repeated structures all over the slides. Next slides means repeating your fonts, the colors, the shapes that you use. And a very easy way to check whether this is the case is to go to the gallery view of your slides, that you see it in the next slide from me, for example. So this is a gallery view of just the slides I'm presenting. And from this, you will see if some slides are standing out because they're all in orange, for example, or whether there's too much text with respect to what you wanted to transmit. Another very important tool for both videos and slides is to use what is called data visualization on the next slides. Google it, you will find manuals, you will find applications to use. So whenever you want to show data to your audience, explore what are the possibilities for this data to be portrayed in a way that is not standard. What I'm showing you here is a way of portraying, for example, the directories on a computer in a very, very elegant and also interactive way. Last few minutes of my talk is about the delivery, actually. So the speech is on the next slide, is what you can do with your voice and your physical presence when you can do it with your physical presence. Again, next slide, the scope is to not have your audience dead like this, but in the next slide, you see, you want to see a captivated audience listening to you. I admit it's very, very difficult to do it in an online situation at the moment, but when we get back slowly to normal, this is something to always keep in mind. Look at your audience to see whether they're attentive. Again, a very important thing to do is to know your audience, in the next slide. And in this case, it's not only who they are, but how many are they going to be? What's the setting going to be like? Is it going to be a big theater? Is it going to be a small room? And how can I connect to them? Because, for example, in big theater situations, typically you have the lights in front of you, you're totally blinded, and you don't see anyone. So you'll just have to rely on your feelings about how the audience is reacting on the very loose information that you can get from some laughters or some comments that you can feel. For me, a very fundamental ingredient of a successful presentation is enthusiasm. The next slide is really what will sort of oblige your audience to be with you. Nobody can really escape a person who is putting all of their soul in their presentation and they are trying to capture you at the time. And besides your attitude, there are also tricks that you can use to make them interested. Next slide, one of the tricks is to ask them questions. They can be very easy ones. They should actually be very easy ones. And nobody wants to be, asked the questions as if it was a teacher asking the classroom. It's just a matter, a way to keep the audience alive, interested. And also, once you ask the first question, they will pay more attention because they're going to be expecting you to ask another one. And even if you don't do it, they're going to be a bit worried that this might happen. So they will still be paying more attention to you. You can also, next slide, call for action. So ask them at the end of the presentation, I would like you to think about this, or when you walk out of this room, you could do that. And this is also something very, very powerful. Now, whenever you can, in the next slide, make eye contact with your audience. Do not stare, meaning do not just choose a person and fix on that one. It can be very, very awkward for the person, but I've seen a lot of speakers doing it. You don't even realize it. Pay attention to it. Try to scan the room, so looking from one side to the other, and it has to be progressive scanning. You don't have to be, moving your head all of the time like that, but just try to look at everyone. Gestures, next slide. There are all sorts of theories about certain gestures. Open arms, meaning openness, closed attitude. In the end, is the whole of your body that is going to transmit a message. I'm Italian. Gestures for me are natural. A couple of times I gave interviews where they asked me to keep my hands steady because afterwards they were going to process the video and add animation. I think it was the toughest time of my life, and I hope it will never happen to me again. But each of us has his or her own different habit. So just try to know what is your habit and try to temper it. If you know that you move your hands too much, then try to lower it. If you find yourself always standing straight in any position, well, think about what is the message you're giving your audience and try to add some gestures to when you're talking. As soon as you enter on stage, the first thing to do is to find your balance. The next slide. Balance is different for men and women because of the position of our hips. So we will naturally have different positions. Women tend to like more to have one foot in front of the other, while for men standing at a good 30 centimeters of feet apart is more comfortable. But take your time to adjust, find the position on stage before you start talking. For your voice, the next slide. The posture and breathing are essential. If you can, find some videos or follow some courses on belly breathing in particular that is going to give your diaphragm the sensitivity it needs to have a steady voice. Try to speak clearly, regulate your volume, don't shout or whisper. One trick to do it, we are all very nervous when we are starting, for example, in a room with the microphone, because we never know what's the level of the microphone. So one trick to do it is to speak when you are exhaling. So when you're starting, take a breath and start talking when you are exhaling, because it's easier for your voice to come out at a controlled level and not to have a too high pitch, for example, at the beginning. And once you know how the microphone is working, then you will adjust it. Again, next slide, try to keep a rhythm that is neither too quick nor too slow. Do some pauses, vary your pitch, your tone, and volume. It comes with practice, and very often you will forget it, but it doesn't matter as long as you have it in the back of your mind and you try to go back to it several times. Next slide, don't start with, so today I'm here. That's very typical when we are all nervous. It's natural, but try to resist it. Try not to use filler words. For example, these are small interjections that you use just to gain time. It seems silly, but if you're chewing a gum, well, put it out away before starting to talk. I've seen some speakers forgetting or just having the habit of not doing it. It's very awkward and not really pleasant. Practice is what will help you be a great speaker. And the shorter the speech, the more you have to practice it. I write down most of my speeches. And whenever they are, they have to be less than, let's say, 15 minutes, in particular less than 10 minutes. I write them to the last word because I know how many words per minute, more or less, I can speak comfortably, and it changes depending on the language. So when I write the text, I can see from my word processor how many words I've written and whether they are I'm good with the amount of words that I'm planning to say in 3 minutes. If you're off by a huge factor, then you have a problem and it's better to cut it down. Couple of really practical tricks. Just before starting to talk, avoid too cold beverages. They will just strangle your throat. Avoid coffee and tea unless you are used to it, because you don't need another adrenaline rush, honestly. Avoid milk and dairy products because they coat your throat and your vocal cords ever so slightly, and your speech will come out a bit blurred. Breathe. 3 deep breaths are demonstrated to slow down your heart rate right away. They send a signal to your brain that everything is fine and everything will work exactly as you wanted it. And visualize yourself. Just imagine yourself at the end of your speech, very successful in front of a clapping audience. Seems silly, it all contributes to calming you down. Now, that's how you plan all your conference, your presentation. It never goes like that. There's always things happening, and how it really happens, you see in the next slide, is that, well, as always, the mic will not working, the previous speaker is late, etc. And you have to just go with the flow and do the best you can. One very good thing to remember is that the audience wants to listen to a good speaker. So the audience is by default on your side. It's my next slide. So don't think of the audience as an enemy, but think about the audience as an ally. So they will understand everything that goes wrong and you can just forget about it. And my last words are in these two last slides. One is all the rules and advice I've given you. It's just advice, and rules are sometimes also made to be broken. Some of them, let's say, are more common sense than others. Others, you have to find your own way, because one size does not fit all, definitely. So the last slide that I leave you with is really, you have to find your way and your delivery style and also your visual communication style. And when you're comfortable, this will become your style and it will evolve with time. Don't think that you'll ever stop. If you like to give speeches, or even if you don't like to, but you will have to because either of the job you've chosen or because you want to participate in other hackathons, every time it will be different. Every time you will add practice, you will learn something, you will look at the other speakers and learn something from them, and you will evolve. But that's the beauty and actually the charm of being a speaker and a presenter as a part of your life. And thank you very much all for the attention, and I'll be very happy to take your questions.
Are there any questions from the audience regarding this presentation? The presentation about how to present.
Exactly.
Well, if not, I would say thank you very much.
Clear and understandable. Thanks. That was the aim.
But that's what it's all about, right?
Yeah. My last message is really also profit of the hackathon time to practice, but also to listen to the others, because you will always find something that you like about other speakers. In some cases, it will make you conscious about your own mistakes. Oh, well, there are a number of words in different languages. Much more in Italian. I can't remember the numbers. I have it written down. I always go back to my number figures. Let me see what's my number. And it's a bit personal. I'll tell you mine because they are a bit... find my file. So I normally go at around 150 words per minute because I know that I'm a fast speaker and I know that I tend to go faster when I talk in public. And this is something also that you will have to check yourselves. Some people slow down when they are giving the final talk with respect to the arts. The majority of us, we go faster. So try to get a gauge for it because it's nice to finish a bit earlier than the time, but not too much. If you're given 5 minutes and you finish in 4 minutes, people might feel like, well, this person didn't have enough to say. So being at the mark is really useful. So it's about 150 words per minute for me in English, and about in Italian is different also because the length of the average length of the words in Italian is different. So normally we count by characters there, but it's a bit more. In that language. And in French, I don't have much the habit of checking it because it rarely happens to me that I have to give very short speeches in French. You find a lot of resources online also for this. I advise you to have a look at them. Start with the general benchmark and then find yours with a bit of time.
Are there any other questions from the audience? Apparently not. Well, on behalf of the Versus Virus team, I really like to thank you, Manuela, for coming on our webcast and having holding this talk. And we'd also like to thank our participants to joining in and listening. And yeah. I wish all of our participants happy hacking, and many thanks to you again, Manuela.
Thanks a lot for the invitation, and good luck to everyone.
Thank you very much.